Nice, ah, the gold badge.
show the camera.
Really nice, ah.
Show the camera.
I like it. I like the badge. I don't like the jersey.
Okay. This one is what?
This one is, this year is our year. Like every other year. Welcome to Kiss My Badge, covering the most watched league in the world for the fans, by the fans. Of course, this time, one game has played already. Okay, almost all teams have played the first game. So the season has kick-started. So far, which team has impressed you the most? Have you
Leeds.
Watched?
Almost got it.
Yeah.
Almost.
When I was growing up, collecting, you know, the sticker books and all that, Leeds is one of those teams that I actually liked because they had a wonderful set of players at that time. Mm. They had Viduka, Alan Smith that we signed him the day they got relegated, and then Harry Kewell. So they had good players to start off. So so I mean, honestly speaking, I for me personally, I have nothing against Leeds. It's a team that I actually admired. So it was very nice to see them go up this year, which is a crazy year for the entire world. So Leeds coming up in 2020 is another whirlwind fact that you can seal it in history. But the fact that they came up and their first game was against the defending champions.
Defending champions versus defending champions.
Exactly.
Right, so cool.
Exactly.
Yeah. And Premier League versus championship. Mm.
And what an amazing game that was.
Yes,
honestly,
it is.
What an amazing
fantastic game.
Yes, fantastic game.
I mean, for the neutrals, I'm not siding, you know, your team and Leeds. But for the neutral, it was a fantastic game. I mean, finally, you can see, you know, like Van Dijk. Okay, he can actually make mistakes.
He's human.
Yeah.
He's human. We've been saying that all the while. It's just that.
And he made mistakes with Arsenal also, right?
Yeah.
I mean, he's starting to make mistakes. That's a point to note. But the fact that, I mean, I was kind of surprised when, you know, the goals that Leeds scored, right? Like Alisson, he also, his reaction time a bit slower. I feel. So I feel like, you know, this Liverpool is showing some
cracks.
I mean, it's still early.
Early days.
But do
exactly.
you guys find it troubling? Because Leeds aside, their performance aside, right? You guys got two penalties, one Van Dijk mistake. So overall, right? The performance is not great, and this is following up from last season whereby you guys have been lucky winning that single goal, and even though you're not playing well, somehow you get that win, you get that 3 points, and it seems to be continuing in this game week one. You know, is it a concern for you?
Okay, I will rewind. We go back to the 90s. Sir Alex Ferguson's Manchester United. Okay, that was the time when, because I knew, I was watching football during that era, all right? That period when Man U was like close to losing a game. You were like, yes, they're finally going to draw. They're going to find, and somehow or rather within the last few minutes, they find that extra push.
Fergie time.
And they get the winning goal and they just take all 3 points despite playing like a team that is in relegation trouble.
Yeah.
That, to me, is the making of champions. All right, that they can don't show up for 89 minutes, and 1 minute they show up, they take the 3 points and they move. So, okay, yes, there are concerns that I understand where you're coming from. There are concerns about defense, all right, which is supposedly the tightest defense in the EPL over the last two seasons. And basically, nobody has changed. Keeper is still Alisson, you still have Trent, you still have the same four. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, what are the things that maybe you can attribute to? Okay, crowd, could it be one of the factors that previously you had the Anfield, the crowd at Anfield, like, that's actually driving the whole team on, that now suddenly it's basically it's silence. All right, I mean, apart from the speakers that are playing whatever sound that they are playing.
Sound effects, like FIFA.
Yeah, sound effects. So, I think it's, okay, I think there is, we do not need to ring the alarm bells, okay, after just one game. And naturally, Leeds had nothing to lose over the first game. So they will definitely go for it. And so I look at it, it's like, let's judge again after maybe about 5 to 6 games, then you can see whether is the, are the same problems that are really, really starting to appear. Yes, I agree with Shakesh. Alisson could have done better, especially for the first and third goal, because I would expect a keeper of his level to be at least getting his hands to the ball. Mm. Yeah. Mm. And of course, Van Dijk is like, yeah, I think the one mistake per season, he has probably used it. Okay, so yeah.
And oh, yeah, I mean, overall, this year, we can, I mean, it's going to be exciting. We're going to see a lot of goals. And the whole reason for this is also fatigue. I think fatigue will definitely play a part.
Fatigue kicking,
And it will show over the course. And you'll probably see like lesser teams like Leeds, you know, all your, you know, destined for a relegation team putting a hard fight because they've got nothing to lose.
Yeah.
I mean, you know.
So teams, just to update, for those who do not know, right, this new season, there's no in-between water break.
Yep.
And we are back to three substitutes. Yeah. I think one of the main reasons is that there was some argument that the lesser teams do not have the depth. So it will be more advantageous for the bigger teams. There were 5 substitutions. So that's why they went back to 3 substitutions.
To me, right, for Liverpool, example, we cannot discount one thing. Leeds, you were saying, is destined for relegation. No, I don't think so.
No, I call them a lesser team, but not.
For me, if you look at the pedigree that they have, Leeds, the way they play last season, I didn't watch much, but because they were coming up, I tried to watch a bit of their highlights, right? And having Bisla as the coach, as a manager, he is a genius. One of my friends told me that he wrote a book, he is a tactical genius. This guy brings Leeds up. I mean, after 16 years, this is the first battle that he had with Liverpool, right?
Yeah.
The way they play is reminiscent of how Liverpool played like 2 seasons ago. Don't care about defense, just attack. And they are not scared of anybody, they just attack. So to me, I won't discount Leeds as a team. They were very impressive. They were playing with intent. They passed the ball quickly. They were pressing the high line as well. We were also pressing up the high line. So it's like, wow, watching them is so entertaining.
I think moving on, right, then the other team that is impressive is Everton.
Yes.
With Ancelotti at the helm. Mm. And he got in a very, very big signing. What do you call it?
Marquee signing.
Yeah, a marquee signing, right, in James Rodriguez.
James Rodriguez.
Yes.
Oh. Yes.
And of course, the other two midfielders are a new signing as well.
Alan from Napoli.
The Korea, is it? No.
Dakore from Watford.
Yeah. And that's right. Is the play is totally different from the last season.
And it was a tough opponent.
And it was Spurs, right?
Yes, it was Spurs.
It was
Mourinho Spurs at Tottenham Hotspur Stadium, which that makes it even more impressive.
Yes, a new stadium is so big. It's so nice. Kudos to Spurs. But I have to say, the way they play, so nice. The stadium nice.
Like toilet bowl.
No, maybe from inside, don't see toilet bowl. Clean toilet bowl. New toilet bowl. It's very nice.
But I think personally for James Rodriguez, right? Okay, because he was... I think everybody remembers 2014 World Cup. Okay, yes. That was the World Cup that the world came to know about this Colombian fella.
Yes.
All right. And subsequently, of course, we all know that his move to Real Madrid and his loan move to Bayern Munich didn't exactly pan out very well. So perhaps making a move to a club like Everton, all right, perhaps it could actually be more beneficial to James. Maybe the step taken for Real Madrid and Bayern Munich may be just too big a jump for him. Mm-hmm. And you know that at clubs like Real Madrid, if after 10 games, they don't see anything in you, they don't give you a chance. They will not give you any time to settle down. You go in, you are expected to settle down. So maybe making a move to Everton, where he knows that Ancelotti is probably going to be building the team around him, I think that could actually be a beneficial move for James.
Ancelotti is his previous manager. He's been following for the past 2 clubs. Yes. Right?
So I believe Ancelotti sees something in James. I mean, I do not want him to be going down as the 2014, the boy that was still stuck in the 2014 World Cup. And it's already 2020, it's 6 years on. And I think his career has actually went downhill from there. Yeah, so I mean, I hope that after this, I mean, the move to Everton, I mean, of course, although I don't really like it, that Everton that
got
going to come in. Yeah, but I think from the footballing perspective, it's a good move for both club and player.
Impressive, yeah.
I mean, you just look at how the league has been transforming over the years. I mean, now you look at Everton, they can be like contenders for number three, number
four. They're dark horse. I think they're the dark horse.
Yeah, yeah. From the way they play, it's good.
Yeah. I mean, they've got a good midfield.
Hate to say, but yes.
Yeah. Good midfield they've got. If the he, you mean you can throw Andre Gomes, who's got Barca caliber. And he's got a Barca centre back, Mira. So the you know the he's been. I mean Ancelotti, I guess, it's just amazing to see because first of all, I never expected Ancelotti to come to Everton. You know, of all teams in the world.
But you expected what?
Yeah, because Ancelotti is not that kind of that mold of manager that he wants to build something.
Exactly.
He usually will take a club that is ready made. You know what I mean? From the clubs that he has managed, AC Milan, you know, Bayern Munich, Real Madrid, he has always taken something that is
managed finished Chelsea product. Also, won Chelsea too.
Correct.
Yes.
Everton is definitely a work in progress. It's definitely a work in progress. So I was very surprised when Ancelotti took the job because I actually expected him to land up at Arsenal at that point in time.
Wanted him.
I was actually thinking that Arsenal would actually get him. But I was surprised that Everton actually got him in the end.
I wanted him specifically because of what he did at Chelsea. I was there watching it when he came in as a caretaker. He just took over just one season and he won. He kind of transformed Chelsea lah. Within that short period of time.
Yeah.
And I do not know why he left. But he really impressed.
It has to be like a wholesome dish, right? You have to have every ingredient to come together. And at Chelsea at that point in time when he came in, good players were already there. They just needed someone to spearhead their intent, come up with tactics. And I mean, it's the same for like at United, where we had Moyes, football genius, he screwed up the perfectly cooked soup that Sir Alex left him. He ruined it. He added his own spices and all that. Then, throw away. And then came Wang Hal, who did pretty impressively. I mean, he did win cups for us. And then Mourinho came. And, the highest he achieved was second.
And he won your two trophies.
Europa. Despite what you have, you have to have a good leader and you have to have, good men around. And it's just so nice that Everton, they've been always on the rise, but never hitting the kind of heights that, they would want to. But now they've got a good head, an experienced head, an extremely experienced head. And now he's got the quality now. He's got the ingredients now. So I think he's going to make a hell of a
difference.
I feel that for Everton, right, it's always been like the Merseyside team, there's two, of course, Liverpool and Everton. So they always have been the one that is shadowed by Liverpool's presence. Yeah. Always the one that's being, like City maybe was before the transformation or before the oil money, whatever. So at this point, when he takes over, we can see the intent of the owners of Everton or the board for Everton who wants a change now. The intent is there. Them buying the players, although it's for 2 years for James Rodriguez, I think we can see. Well, he comes in straight away, he just sprays the ball. Even though it's like the first time that all of them are playing together, and if you remember, Gomez was injured last season against Spurs.
Yeah,
and
after now the horrific clash with Arsenal.
And he played like so well also, the way he played. It's like, you can see that, this is the first game and they are already gelling so well. So in time to come, they will gel even more. And they are going to get very dangerous.
The most important thing is Doucouré. Like, he is like a cleanup crew, Go and attack. If, you wayward balls, I'll come and clean up.
There was one time Mora almost go through already. Then he just stick out the
Yeah.
poke, toe poke. And
no, I think,
oh my goodness,
I think for Everton, fantastic. What has to be said, okay, this is not the first time that they are throwing money at signings. Okay, they have done this for quite a few windows. I think everybody knows that. But I think what makes this window very different, is that the one at the top is Ancelotti. And I think that this is a guy that knows exactly what to do with his players. It's not like the previous ones when Ronald Koeman was splashing cash and everything, and in the end he got himself sacked after like what, how many games? What? Six or seven? I can't remember what's it. Yeah, so it's that's the difference when I agree with Shakesh. It's the person that is at the top. Okay. Ancelotti, I think, is he will do a good job for Everton. Definitely, okay, maybe not Champions League places, but I think they will be in with a shot for the Europa League places, definitely.
Any other impressive players that impress you during the game week one?
Willian.
Most assists in the Premier League for the game
week. Okay, but yeah, Willian, to me, okay, I think we talked about Willian just now. He's an established player himself, all right? He's an established player himself. Then it's like, for him, coming up with two assists on game day one, I think it was pretty impressive. But then again, my question is, if Willian impressed so much and he plays currently in the same position as Pepe, so my question is, what is going to happen to Pepe?
Yeah. Pepe is overpriced and because of some scandal, now under internal investigation, so he's not worth it. In conclusion, he's not worth it.
You just got yourself Pepe. Another Sanchez.
Hashtag pity Pepe.
It's just another Sanchez for them.
Okay lah, he just needs to tweak his defensive skills, right? Just like Ozil. Okay, Ozil? Okay.
Yeah, I don't know what Ozil is doing. He should just hand in a transfer request and get going.
Yan don't know what Ozil is doing.
Yeah. I mean, it's
so like Bale in Madrid.
It's so miserable to see him like sitting down in the bed. It's not a bench nowadays.
It's miserable with 350 grand per week.
Only this much. The miserable.
Maybe uncomfortable like the seat.
Like
you all trust Klopp. I trust Arteta. And Arteta is always, the door is always open. If Ozil wants to fit into the system that Arteta has and follow the non-negotiables and all that, then is I believe he might come back.
I'm pretty sure Arteta will let him play.
Because look at Xhaka. Xhaka happened and then somehow Arteta brought him in and he becomes a better player.
True.
He's a better player.
So I'm open to Ozil.
We shouldn't be forgetting the hat-trick hero, Mo Salah. I think that is definitely one player that really it's probably he does this way too often. That maybe his performances are now is deemed like very ordinary.
Man.
You know, but his second goal that he scored against Leeds, I tell you, that is
immaculate. Out of three goals, he scored two penalties.
No, but this is overall play. His overall play.
The one thing I noticed about Salah is, okay, he's got the skills to take players on, right? He can dribble. Shooting power, we witnessed that. Shooting power is out of the world. He can blast balls very straight, very accurate. So there's no doubts on his shooting.
Okay.
But the key pointer about Salah, or two pointers, is speed and running into spaces. That he does it very brilliantly. Because if you see, he's got a very capable and evenly matched player on the other side, Mane. You know, they are about the same caliber. Mane can shoot, Mane can run, Mane find spaces. But one thing Salah does better than Mane is, you know, that positioning. His positioning play is a lot better. Mane tends to, you know, drift a bit. Whereas Salah is very direct. He runs at the defender. If you notice, he dribbles and he intimates and he makes the defender.
He charges at
pull back. And that creates the opening, right? The defense get pushed and then you've got players on the side to spray, or even you take the shot. I mean, Salah, we've seen Salah taking shots at acute angles from that, you know, small box. So who was your star player for game week one? Share and discuss in the comments below. Like and subscribe Friends TV, Kiss My Badge, and shout out to Matchday FS.